Good afternoon, members. It's now been pointed out. Before we start the business of business, can I request members to ensure that any items related to private or confidential or exempt information are not on display until such time as information is required in the confidential settings. Request any person present intending to record the proceedings of the meeting to make themselves known to the chair. So I'd like to welcome Mr. and Mrs. Price. Thank you for coming along today. I've got an announcement to make. The authority meeting on the 16th of December 2014, following the consideration of the JJC official opening report at the authority meeting on the 2nd of October, requested that members consider changing the start time of the authority meeting on the 16th of December. As a result of the response from members regarding the proposed time change, the Chair of the Authority has confirmed that the Authority meeting on the 16th of December will commence at an earlier time of 11 a.m. and any pre-group meetings to be held at 10:30 hours if required to ensure there is no clashes with the event. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Right, preliminary matters. Apologies for absence at top. Councillor Clavin leaving needs to leave early. Apologies received from Kieran Simmons and Ian Cummins as representatives. Any other apologies for absence?
I may be leaving it here. I have to go, of course.
Any declarations of interest for members? To consider the matter of urgency, which is the special papers. Item 2, the minutes of the Community Protection meeting held on the 29th of July is submitted for approval. Are they agreed?
Agreed.
Now move on to item 4 on the main agenda. Item 3, sorry.
The purpose of the report is to request that members approve the contents of the 2015-17 integrated financial plan, supplements subject to a 12-week consultation about the implementation and the IMP supplements is intended to take. And the recommendation that members approve the contents of the 2015-17 integrated financial plan supplements subject to that consultation period. The actual IRMP itself is a familiar format for us, but it was a supplement rather than a completely new draft of the document. But it does introduce the document and talks about the financial setting in which the Oxford organisation and services operating within. Reflects our mission and our objectives and aims, excellence operational preparedness, excellence operational response, excellence intervention and protection, and excellent people. And it goes on to detail our community, particularly in relation to the demographics. It also encapsulates the financial challenge facing the authority on page 16 and 17 and identifies how our money is received and how the money is spent. And then it goes on to detail part of the supplement of our performance over the previous 12 months. Then it goes on to detail our update in relation to IRMP 2013-16 on the actions that have been taken to date in relation to the delivery of those integrated planning actions. And that covers off operational preparedness. It goes on to detail our work we do around operational resilience, national resilience particularly. Talk about our operational response to the changes that we've made more recently to our models of operation, reduction in the number of firefighters, details of the mergers and plans for 2015 and beyond. Talk about some of the details in relation to prevention and protection, again reflects on our performance in the past 12 months and I look forward to 2015 and beyond, and again a better shame for our people. Then talks about our medium-term strategy 2012-17, where we conclude that termination of this supplement, and then again reinforces our policy objectives, which we then set between 2012 and 2017. One thing I will bring to members' attention is on page 32, policy objective five, if the target that is set is no longer the target for the authority, the authority has made a change to that, and you will recall, we've moved away from a quota of in respect of recruitment to recruiting the votes of the service that reflect the community we share, and that will be an amendment which is made upon part of the release. So just to reinforce the request for members, the recommendation that members approve the content of the 2015-17 integrated management plan subject to a 12-week consultation period. I'm happy to take any questions about any specific detail contained within.
Thank you. Any comments or questions from members? Tom.
Thanks. On page 31, with policy objective 2 about risk factors associated with people living in rented properties, the action point for this only seems to relate to registered social landlords. And what was on my mind was that the private landlords were, I would have thought, there was a likelihood of more risks than with social registered landlords. I just wondered where we were on that.
Absolutely, you are quite correct. The biggest risk is probably the flex properties owned by private landlords. The challenge for us as an authority is we have the data available to us around our hotel properties, so social landlords, we are able to establish the numbers, the locations, who owns what people they are, a better provider of tenants and property. The challenge for us is, and we do, let me reassure members, we do work with and so on and so forth, just for extension of course, those lands and their communities and the people who are living in their properties. It's very difficult for us to be able to identify all of those properties and make that decision when individuals don't come forward. So we are basing it on the fact that we know of all of our RSL properties, where those properties are, and we can establish better data sources, but we make sure that we continue to work with the private entity sector to enforce some of the fire safety measures we would want to know.
Please.
Yeah, just on that one, Phil. The other thing I think is just brought out in charter for private landlords, and I wonder how you're engaging with that initiative.
Absolutely, and we are aware of that, and we've been out and spoke to them in our conversations about what is a national project really around Blue Watch, which is about organisations going in and accrediting to a greater or lesser degree that part of an event at home. So if you are talking about student accommodation, if you're looking to place your child in student accommodation in Liverpool, you would want to place them somewhere which would be accredited in some way, shape or form. Now, we can't reassure them that that's a safe property, but what happens in that circumstances, bad pub network, may well go into the premise, look around the fire safety measures, look around the fact that we've had carbon monoxide installed and so on and so forth, and we've got safety checks, and credit it on that basis, and then when the individual comes to do that, we're more comfortable with my daughter or son going and taking the space in that home or that property part of them, anything else. That continues to be a discussion that we're having.
Thank you, Chair. It's just to continue on both of those. The charter itself is going to, the implication of it is that there will be a register, hopefully by the time it's all finished, all private landlords. So that's it. It's going on the back of the legislation that's there. So, can you have a report back on that? Because it's what I can gather from the work we're doing in my board is that literally we hope to have every landlord registered, whether they are themselves or private, and specifically, as with most of them, as they don't even live in this country. As many of them actually live in Southern Ireland, etc. So we feel like this is the kind of charter we need so we know who they are for problems in the future. So maybe once you get a report back, you come back with us on that, because it makes an important issue.
Absolutely, Chair. And if I was to say there's an aspiration to be able to map out all of those privately rented accommodation, whether they be RSL property or they be privately rented across Merseyside, and report back against that quality objective, that would absolutely be the aspiration. But we are working with session code, we're working within the data set that we have available to at this point in time. Once that data case is available and we're confident that we can report back effectively to the members, absolutely we will do. So that work is ongoing, we continue to work with all of the local authorities in the city, and the personnel properties, which is presented as well as an on shelf.
Thank you.
Just a comment from me then. The actual consultation for all the departments, will it be a full consultation that you do, but usually I have going around all the fire districts with DEO?
Yes, absolutely. And the format will be exactly the same. The accessible will have it onto the website, it will be from scale surveys and so on, so forth, and the village report will be based on.
Is there any need to accept the recommendations to approve that and go to consultations for 12 weeks? Thank you. And now it's item 4. Page 49 to 56.
Mr. Chair, the purpose of this report is to advise members of the operational recruitment strategy for 2014-15 and to seek your endorsement for the construction terms that we are proposing be applied. At the budget meeting on the 27th of February, members approved subject to considering the outcomes of public consultation. The substantive structural changes to the operational response model that would result in four of our existing whole-time fire engines being crewed on a whole-time attend basis, and that of course is what delivers the in-year operational response savings required for 2015-16, as those say. As you're aware, members, those budget reductions take effect as of the 1st of April 2015. Subsequently, at the meeting on the 2nd of October, earlier this month, members approved the merger of Heighton and Wiston to deliver a one-pump whole-time retained station at Prescott. That was after the public consultation. And you also approved the 12-week public consultation, which we're in the middle of now, and the public meetings commence on Monday, which is for the merger of West Kirby and Lutton at the youth centre in Greasby. Again, one pump whole time retained. You approved an outright closure of Alton, again subject to public consultation, where the fire engine at Alton would be relocated to Old Swan, again to be crewed on a whole time retained basis. And as you're aware, members, we have a further merger proposal for St. Helens, which is a merger of the existing Eccleston Fire Station merged with the existing St. Helens Fire Station and new site within the St. Helens Town Centre. When I spoke to the report on the 2nd of October, I committed to presenting a separate report to members explaining how we would achieve the whole time retained crewing on the former branches. What I said at the time, you may recall that we've received very little interest from existing staff to undertake whole-time retained contracts, and we've sought expressions of interest on two occasions previously in order to do that. The contractual options, if you like, to achieve whole-time retained and the associated implications thereof are listed in paragraphs 11 through 19 in the report, which is on pages 50 to 52. What I'd like to do is to focus specifically on paragraph 13, which provides the detail on the individual options and if I may, Chair, I'll just explain those in a little bit more detail on that. Ostensibly, we have four options to consider realistically. The first would be the outright recruitment of community retained firefighters. Now, I don't intend to go over the old ground as to why that's not something that I recommend that we do, despite the fact that clearly Ken Knight was of the view that that was the future in terms of the UK Fire Rescue Service. And it's clear that DCLG, or certainly our civil service colleagues, share that view, certainly share the view of Ken Knight. And that is something we could do. We could seek to recruit community retained firefighters. And there is no question in my mind there would be a lot of people who would apply if we re-advertised those roles. Remember, previously, the last recruitment campaign we undertook was the recruitment of full-time staff, 21-hour contracts, effectively part-time staff. And that is something that we could do, although to just do that in isolation in itself would not deliver the additional flexibility around the retained that we require. And there are other issues there around retention as much as anything, because the view expressed by the staff on the 21-hour contracts is, despite the fact that in any given week they may well have worked in excess of 42 hours on occasion, if they were attempting to secure a mortgage or something of that nature, then that could only be viewed on the basis of their contracted 21 hours. Now, that is not to say, members, that in discounting that option at this point in time, that isn't to say that we might not have to come back and revisit that. But the next two options that I'll speak to, the first of which I suspect will be less palatable, but the reality is it may well be something we have to consider, and hopefully bringing us on then to the final option, which is the one at this point in time I favour in truth for the reasons which I'll explain. The third option is the recruitment of, in essence, what you talked about first was a retained contract under 20 hours. But what you could do under the auspices of that contract is offer people additional shifts, additional voluntary hours. In truth, you could offer them in excess of 42 hours, and we would undoubtedly have the shifts available to give them that additional work. You might take a cynical view that was akin to a 0 hours contract, and whilst in truth it wouldn't strictly speaking be a 0 hours contract, because there would be a guaranteed 10% retaining fee, and the reality is that is a contract that's in operation throughout the country. The majority of the country is covered by retained firefighters. And as I've said previously with the 21-hour contracts, that's not to say that we might not have to consider that at some point in the future. And we might, members, and I need to make that really clear, that we might have to do that. The final option is to offer a 32-hour contract. And the reason that you would offer 32 hours is because that would give you the option of 8, 12, or indeed 24-hour shifts, averaged out over an 8-week reference period, indeed over an 8-day reference period if needs be, but to also offer a 42-hour whole-time retained contract, because that, in the end, is the primary objective. And if we recruited people on 32 hours, then the reality is they would absolutely end up doing 42 hours a week. But the sum, if you like, of a 32-hour contract equates to, and with the 42 hours on time retained, equates to about 85% of the firefighter's salary. So that's in excess of £20,000 a year for a competent firefighter. So whilst it's not the same and clearly a competent firefighter on 42 hours would be on £28,000 a year, if you add on the 10% retainment fee, of course that adds another £2,800 onto that. And that isn't to say that absolutely certain that these people would be earning the full amount of the fact that every other firefighter is on. But this is about flexibility. And it is about achieving whole-time retained, not community retained, because we want to maintain fire appliances crewed by firefighters who have the levels of competence that our whole-time staff are. I know that's an argument that I've been speaking previously on numerous occasions, and I don't propose to go back through that. So at this point in time, that would be my preference for the reasons that that's going on. What I would say is that discussions continue with our colleagues from the Fire Brigade Union and the Fire Officers Association as to how we might encourage more of our existing whole-time staff to take on the TAFE contracts. That work is being treated as a priority. We've got Mark and Kevin here today, and we were discussing this very issue when we met yesterday at our monthly meeting. It is something that's being progressed through the Joint Secretaries as a priority. And it may well be that we are able to attract sufficient staff to crew the four full-time retained pumps. And if we are, then of course this becomes academic. And that's absolutely something that then we would revisit in terms of the recruitment. So just to reassure members, that is the priority. If we can achieve this through existing staff, then that is absolutely what we want. But I undertook to bring to you options as to how we would achieve a whole time retained plan, so if we couldn't attract sufficient numbers of existing staff, and that is I've described for you there. What I would say is that in any event, we are still going to need to recruit, albeit small numbers. And that may appear on the face of it irrational based on the numbers of firefighters or the number of firefighter posts that we're going to need to lose in order to meet the current savings targets and what we know almost certainly is going to come in the next spending review in terms of the cuts that the authority is likely to face thereafter. The point I would make is, as of today, we employ, I think it's 787 firefighters as of today, which is, we have a budget for 764, so we're employing more people than we actually should have. You're aware of this, we're using reserves to avoid compulsory redundancies. But that figure over the course of the next 5 years, so up to 2020, that figure would drop to below 500 through retirement, so it would be down by financial year 2020-21, we'd be down to 413 firefighters. Now, I've said to you previously, the 2020 vision, we're assuming having just under 600 firefighters there, if the scale of the financial challenge continues in the way we expect it to. So you can see over the next 5 years, what we wouldn't want to do is to be in a position where we had to recruit a lot of people all at once because of the succession planning issues around operational competencies and so forth. So what we're saying is that we will need to recruit in any event. But it's just a question of the type of contracts onto which we recruit. That is the issue that we need to reconcile. And just to stress the point again, in the first instance, if we are able to resolve the whole time retained issues through the existing workforce, that is what we will do as a priority. And we are all committed to doing that. That's myself, that's Phil, that's our colleagues in the FBU and Fowler. Just to reassure you members, that succession planning issue is something we've raised previously. We do have a reserve, a recruitment reserve, which is earmarked and we've reviewed previously to allow us to do that in such a way that it doesn't impact on the financial plan. Details of the positive action campaign undertaken to date are listed at paragraphs 20 to 23, which is on page 52. And the details of the recruitment process follows at paragraphs 24 to 28. Paragraphs 29 to 32 detail the research that's been undertaken by our people and organisational development team in relation to firefighter apprenticeships, which is something that we are very, very keen to explore further. And when we have sufficient detail in that regard, we will bring the report back to you to consider and for you to take a view on that. I'll pause at that point, I'm conscious of that. We spoke a bit longer than I wanted to, but I think it was important just to explain the few issues.
Yeah. I understand the argument for recruiting, because over time we'll lose too many, and it's about sustainability of and continuity in the workforce. But just on those two, the second and the fourth option on page 51, is there any impact of either of those on the degree and level and type of training that firefighters would have? Because I think really it's crucial that they are all trained to those same high standards we already have.
And I think, in truth, Barbara, that is the reason for the, if you like, the 32. All of the firefighters, any firefighter that we recruit, will undergo what will be now a 24-week recruit course, which is focused very much on the operational skill acquisition. The point I made previously around the amount of hours they would actually work, it might be only 42 hours, but possibly more, I doubt it. Therefore, will be exposed to exactly the same amount of training and potential promotion basis than the staff that we have now. That is why it is predicated in the way that we want to design the options.
Great, that's reassuring.
Thanks, yeah. If you can solve those the problem internally and you go for option four, you'll know people at the end of the day who are actually coming on these contracts and will be working 85% of firefighters' wage. Will they be told up front that they will be working with people physically working with them? And maybe will be on less pay? Because a lot of time that causes a lot of antagonism amongst people, and it's very hard to address. And the other thing I was going to ask is, if you're so sure they'll go to 42 hours and you'll offer them the extra shifts, can the shifts be pensionable? Because, again, it's money for your time.
Two good points there, and I'm glad you raised that, because it does give me the opportunity to. In terms of the 85% figure, that is a purely factual figure based on the pro rata salary. The reality is, I don't remember, the people that we bring in on these contracts will be offered additional shifts, undoubtedly. Hence the flexibility. That's why we need to do it this way. When Ken Knight reported in his efficiencies review, he made the point around the very major inefficiency of the existing full-time duty system. And there's no denying that it is rigid and it is very inflexible. What we're trying to do here is to circumvent some of that inflexibility to allow us to maintain that as a duty system. For these individuals, in theory, look, they're getting paid less than they're getting paid exactly the same. The hourly rate would be exactly the same. It's just the amount of contracted hours would be different. In reality, not that they would work the same number potentially more hours. The issue around the pensionability, the additional hours that they work would be worked on their retained contract, which is pensionable in its own right. Therefore, they would make it that they in effect would accrue two pensions, the whole time pension and the retained pension. So effectively they'd be getting two, which when you combine them both would amount to the same, because it would be the same pension to me, that the 2015 pension scheme, it will be two pensions on the same scheme, if that makes sense. I know that on the face of it might sound confusing, but it's like take the second job in the same job, if that makes sense. It'd be like in Santander having two jobs doing exactly the same thing, but two contracts, both of which would be pensionable. It's just one of those nuances that's peculiar to the Fire and Rescue Service. But to reassure you, the additional hours would be pensionable unless they chose to opt out of the pension.
My question's just been asked to you.
Excuse
me, Chair.
If we end up in a situation where an employee, a firefighter, actually says, actually, I only want to work 32 hours a week, I don't want the extra hours a week, how's that based on your plan?
in that sense, that would be absolutely fine, because we would still have more than enough shifts to accommodate that wish. And the reality is, we do have staff who work reduced hours.
Yeah, I'm sure.
We do, so we would accommodate that in the same way as we accommodate existing staff. But if somebody did just wish to work 32 hours, the reality is, and they couldn't do that on, it couldn't be two days, two nights, because that would be 42 hours at 1,000. The very fact that it is less than that, that is what derives the flexibility. I can't dress it up any other way. This is bringing in self-fostering, which is what we need to do in order to make us more flexible, more responsive to what we need to be, and to circumvent some of the challenges that Ken Wright has raised, if you like, through the efficiencies review. Now, make no secret of this. This is circumventing the inefficiencies of the labour. That is what we're trying to do here. But we are trying to do it for the right reasons. It is to maintain whole-time crewing, but to do so in a way which is as cost-effective as it can be. Because, of course, the most cost-effective way to do this is retained.
I think the point I was trying to get at, Chair, was that we would end up in a situation where somebody is on space of 32-hour contract and then effectively be obliged to do those extra hours. That's the issue I was trying to get at.
Sorry, apologies.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I think you answered my question. In fact, they wouldn't be obliged to do those extra hours. That's what I was getting at.
It's kind of a flow of questions. We considered the open trade option, which is option 4, we very aptly described why we have the option. You described before that you're still in consultation with the staff side of the unions about this matter, and you might be able to resolve it within, as part of those negotiations. Is there a particular timescale that you're envisaging?
That engagement with the rec bodies is our number one priority. We've prioritised it. The issues in relation to the HR policies are, I don't speak out of turn here, Mark, but I believe we're not far off resolution in that regard. That was the only other outstanding issue in terms of the mutual relations that needed to be resolved. And so Mark has just confirmed that we are at the point of resolution. That means all of our effort now will be expended on seeking resolution to the issue around the full-time retained. But to make the point that we still need to future-proof the operational response model, because the game here is to maintain full-time. Therefore, the point Barbara made earlier on, helpfully, is to maintain the highest standard of operational competence and therefore response in terms of the service and quality of the service that we deliver.
Any other comments or questions? Matt, would you like to make any comment?
No, other than to say we've never sort of moved away from the fact that despite the FPU's view on maintaining the same supplies. My own personal belief is that the whole time firefighters taking the same contract gives a much more in-depth skill set. And we've never been sacrificed from that service management system. That's been our vision for the way forward. The body work at the moment up to the 18th of November, I think the date is to set up all of this. The body work is around how do we achieve that and bring all our firefighters along to get to the call center. Take up those contracts and get the best possible conditions within those contracts as well. So the work is ongoing, and I'm pretty committed to say that as well. I hope you have the 18th.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any comments? So, can I just ask all the members of the EC?
Yes.
And the other side of that, right, Chancellor. So it's quite a long recommendation. Is there a way that the recruitment process contained within this report? And that was an opening dot. The recruitment and training firefighters on flexible contractual arrangements specified within the report specifically. I can combined 32-hour overtime short, 42-hour overtime and trade contract, average over a 7-day period. Is the reading note and endorse? Feasibility and recruitment by firefighters are 120 hours retained contract to explore in order to future-proof recruitment and maximise flexibility. Reading note and endorse? And the development of apprenticeship model for future recruitment. Next item is item 5, which is an exempt item, so people leave and thank you for your commitments today.